Hello, everyone, and thanks for checking in with the last scheduled presentation of this installment of VVMAT. Our next speaker, Armand Khan, got his bachelor's and master's degrees from the Birla Institute of Technology and Science in India in 2014. He then moved to the USA and did his PhD in mechanical engineering at Northwestern University in Illinois with the advisors Jane Wang and Yip-Hua Chung, and he finished this thesis in March this year. Armand is not only good in the journal publications department, but also has three patents to his name, and he just joined the mechanics and design team at GE Research. Today, he will be talking about in-situ production of carbon tribofilms, right after this.
Coatings is a peer-reviewed journal of coatings and surface engineering published online by MDPI on a monthly basis.
Hello everyone, my name is Armand and I'm excited to share some of the work that I did as part of my PhD at Northwestern University. So this work was on investigation of in-situ tribofilms and their reaction mechanisms. Going into the outline of my talk, I will briefly go over the background introduction as to what exactly are tribofilms and what is the need of the research that I'm going to present. And then some of the experimental investigation that we conducted on these tribofilms, which were also complemented by reactive molecular dynamics simulations. So I will go into the details of those simulations. And then finally, I will also go briefly over some of the studies that we did in order to seek understanding of tribochemical reactions or tribochemistry. And then finally, I will conclude the talk by outlining major conclusions from this work. So why exactly do we need these in-situ tribofilms? So as we all know, that carbon coatings in the form of as deposited coatings mainly, some of which are shown here, graphite, graphene, and DLC. These kind of films have been used widely as coatings in the mechanical components because they have been shown to reduce both friction and wear. The major problem associated with these coatings is that once they are worn away, they cannot be replenished back without the complete disassembly of the system, which is obviously not a favorable solution. So what we can do to address this? Well, we can produce something that has similar properties to these as deposited films, mainly their friction and wear reducing properties. But such films will be produced as long as there is a lubricant present at the interface. Here actually we use the asperity contacts that are typically associated in boundary lubrication conditions to our advantage. So what will happen is that as a function of time, temperature, friction, or catalysis during this rubbing motion, we can dissociate the lubricant that actually, the hydrocarbons, I should say, that makes up this lubricant package. And then ultimately, those broken entities will combine together to form something called as tribofilms, which can help to reduce both friction and wear. And then the ulterior motive behind this research was also to examine what is the nature of the tribofilms that we are producing. So when we look at the literature, these tribofilms have been claimed to be polymeric deposits or graphitic or DLC films, as you can see from some of the references that I'm showing here. So the inference that these tribofilms are actually DLC is mainly drawn from their Raman signals, wherein the presence of these D and G bands in the Raman signal, which is what a standard DLC also shows, leads to the conclusion that the carbon tribofilms that are formed are actually graphitic or DLC-like. So here we seek to answer those questions. First being, what is the nature of the tribofilms and does the presence of these D and G bands in the Raman spectra actually prove that there are graphitic and, you know, DLC films that are produced? So how exactly do we produce carbon tribofilms in our system? We actually use this molecule that is shown here, which is cyclopropane carboxylic acid, as our lubricant additive, which is CPCA to be short. And the reason behind this molecule is twofold. The first being the presence of this ring strain metastable component, which is a three carbon ring structure. So when we go into the organic chemistry literature, you will find that for a ring structure of carbon to be stable, the internal angle has to be greater than or equal to 109 degrees. And in this case, this is obviously 6 degrees. So this attributes certain metastability in this structure, which is exactly what we want, because we want this molecule to break apart under rubbing conditions. And then the second component is the surface active component, which is the carboxylic acid group, which helps this molecule to go and get absorbed onto the surface through hydrogen bonding. So we conducted a friction test on this ball and disc setup with and without the addition of this lubricant additive, which is CPCA, in the base oil, which was PaO4. Normal load of 10 Newton and linear speed of 0.2 meters per second. So when we look at the tribological performance, we can see that both the friction and wear reductions are achieved after the introduction of this lubricant additive in the base oil. And at the end of the tribo testing, there is also a black deposit that is accumulated on the trailing edge of the wear scar, which is the carbon tribofilm. Going into the next objective, which is the tribofilm characterization. This was kind of the roadmap that we followed. So using CPCA, we obtained a friction product that is obtained using the tribo testing that we have seen already in the last slide. And then there is also a thermal product that I'm going to show in the following slides that we produced from CPCA. And then we examine both of these products and ask, are these products actually DLC? And if not, what are they? So like I said in the last couple of slides, we also produced a thermal product. And the reason for this product was that we were able to obtain sufficiently large quantities of this thermal product, which could be used to analyze using some of the techniques which were not possible by using just the friction product because of the little amount of the friction product that we were able to produce. So in order to produce this thermal product, we took 0.1 grams of iron oxide, mixed it with 0.3 grams of CPCA, heated the mixture at these conditions to obtain this thermal product. So going into the first bit of analysis, which was the Raman spectroscopy, at room temperature, you can see that both the thermal and friction product gives a similar signal as that of a standard DLC, as in the presence of these D and G bands. But when we heat the products at 623 Kelvin for 2 hours, we can see that these D and G bands, they disappear with both the thermal and friction product, whereas they are present in case of a standard DLC. So here we see the first sign that although they look similar at room temperature, but there is something different in both the thermal and friction product as compared to a standard DLC, in that both of them lose their signature DNG bands when heated. And then the second bit of analysis was to examine the presence of ring structures in both the thermal and friction products. You can see that the IR spectroscopy signals of both the thermal and friction products look exactly similar, but rather distinct from a standard DLC, in that both of them lack the FTIR peaks around the 700 centimeter inverse wave number. And this is where any ring structures would show up, which is actually the case of in a standard DLC. And also for the thermal product, when we look at the NMR, there are no NMR peaks in the range of 6 to 8 parts per million, which is again, the ring structures would typically show up. So based on both of these analyses, we can conclude that aromatic peaks were not detected in the triboforms, or the triboforms is actually not graphite-like or DLC-like. So going into the mass spectroscopy results, and this was again done for only thermal product because of the limited quantity drawback associated with the friction product. And here you can see that a lot of peaks are up and above the 1000 mass to charge ratio, which is obviously significantly larger than 86, which is the atomic mass of CPCA, that is our lubricant additive. So here we can conclude that tribofilm is in fact a polymer. And then complementing these experimental investigations, we also conducted reactive molecular dynamics simulations, which will not only help us to gain further confidence in the experimental findings, but also this can reveal some of the atomistic pathways that the lubricant additive follows. So in order to replicate the tribological experimental setup, we took Fe304, because at any given steel surface, there is always a oxide layer that is present. And then 200 CPCA molecules were sandwiched between the two substrates. The simulation was conducted in three stages, the first being the equilibrium conditions for 0.1 nanoseconds, and then normal loading of 3 gigapascal for another 0.1 nanoseconds. And then finally, the sliding, which is done for 1.8 nanoseconds, wherein we take this top substrate and slide it at the speed of 10 meters per second while keeping the bottom substrate to be fixed. So during the simulation, we analyze the carbon fragments. So carbon fragments are any given entity in the simulation that has at least one carbon present in it. And since we took 200 CPCA molecules, there are in total 800 carbon atoms in the system. So in order to make the analysis much more simplified and much more easy to understand, I divided the carbon fragments into three groups. The first group where the carbon fragments had a carbon count of less than or equal to 4, which is labeled as group A here, shown in green. The second group where the carbon count was between 4 to 10, and the third group where the carbon count is greater than 10, which I'm calling as a polymer group. So you can see that as soon as the welding commences at 0.2 nanoseconds, there is a sudden drop in the group A molecules, which signifies a dissociation kind of chemical reaction that is happening. So CPCA molecules are breaking apart. What follows this is the surge in the group B molecules between the 0.2 to 0.4 nanoseconds time frame. And then, interestingly enough, the group C molecules, they increase with time. They continuously increase until they achieve kind of like saturation level, 1.6 nanoseconds. At the end of that time frame, approximately 500 out of 800 atoms are polymerized. So we can say that this kind of strongly suggests the kind of polymerization reaction that is happening. And then we can also look at three timestamps: the beginning of the simulation, the middle of the simulation, and the end of the simulation. What is the distribution of the carbon fragments looking like, and what is the biggest fragment that is present in the simulation? So in the beginning, we had 200 molecules of CPCA, which was again our biggest molecule at that time. And then in the middle of the simulation, that is at 1 nanosecond, we only have approximately 45 CPCA molecules remaining. And the biggest molecule that is present is having the carbon count of 36. And then at the end of the simulation, the biggest fragment has a carbon count of 55. So you can see that the dissociation of CPCA is still continuing. And then what are the major factors that are driving these tribochemical reactions? The first is obviously the temperature spike that is induced as soon as the sliding commences. So you can see that there is a temperature spike and then it kind of settles down as a function of time. And then what also is happening is as a function of this rubbing process, these highly reactive iron atoms are getting exposed So this goes into the tribological interface and also acts like a catalyst in increasing the kinetics of these tribochemical reactions. And then one of the things that we also wanted to figure out actually confirm that we are obtaining the similar product from also the simulations. If you follow a purely thermal process that we get from a friction process. So you can see that the distribution of carbon fragments that are obtained from a purely friction process to that of a purely thermal process are looking very similar to each other, wherein the biggest fragment is around the vicinity of 35. For both the friction and the thermal product. Similar kind of observation also applies at the end of 2 nanoseconds. So this confirms that both the friction and thermal products are similar to each other. We now switch focus to understand some of the factors on which the tribochemical reactions can depend. So in order to do so, we modify the lubricant additive's structure. So taking CPCA as a base candidate, we can arrive at a derivative where the number of polar groups are now increased to 2 instead of 1. So comparing these two can help us to answer what is the effect of adsorption strength on the tribochemical reactions. And then the number of polar, the number of carbon atoms that make up this ring structure can also be modified from 3 to 4. And then understanding the behavior of these two molecules can help us to answer what is the effect of chemical structure on the tropochemical reactions. And then if we add another fourth molecule, that is cyclobutane dicarboxylic acid, which is CBCA, we can understand which of the above two parameters, that is the adsorption strength and the chemical structure, is more critical towards the tropochemical reactions. So we always begin by looking at the friction and wear performance. So here you can see that all the lubricant additives certainly performs better than just the base oil. And if we are to rank all of these in terms of their friction and wear performance, they look something like this, with CPDCA having 3 carbon ring as well as 2 polar groups, certainly performing the best. And then you can see that having 2 polar groups, as is the case for CPDCA as well as CBDCA, seems much more critical towards getting lower friction and lower wear as compared to the metastability in the structure. 4-membered ring with just 1 polar group, that is CBCA, performs the worst. So in order to understand these experimental findings, we also carried out some of the MD simulations. The first targeting the desorption comparison of 1 polar group versus 2 polar group. So here what we did was we took 25 molecules of each of these lubricant candidates, allowed them to get adsorbed onto the surface, and then increase the temperature after 100 picoseconds to 500 Kelvin. So you can see that 1 polar group in case of CPCA certainly does not do well as compared to CPDCA, which has 2 polar groups. So the 2 polar groups increases the residence time of these lubricant additives on the surface. And then this increase in the residence time allows more transfer of energy that you impart from external sources. So it can be either thermal or mechanical that is imparted during the rubbing motion, which certainly helps in getting higher reactivity out of these molecules. And that explains why CPDCA is able to give lower friction and lower wear as compared to CPCA. And then the second aspect is comparing the metastability. So here we took CPCA and CBCA. The difference between the two is that the CPCA has a 3 carbon member ring, CBCA has 4 carbon member ring. And as expected, CPCA shows higher degradation as compared to CBCA, which helps us to understand like why CPCA is showing better friction and wear performance as compared to CBCA. And then finally, we compared the final products that are obtained from replicating the tribological setup in the simulations. So we compared CPCA and CPDCA. Both the structures are shown here. And then 200 molecules of each of them were taken in a separate simulation. The simulation setup looks something like this. And then you can see that at the end of 0.5 nanoseconds, the number of carbon atoms in the biggest entity is just 30 for CPCA, where it is much more in case of CPDCA. The same trend follows even at 1 nanosecond. And then this shows that improved polymerization is happening in case of CPDCA, which again translates to better friction and better wear. By better, I mean lower friction and lower wear. So in terms of conclusions from the work that I presented here, we showed that CPCA as an oil additive is able to show excellent anti-friction and anti-wear behavior. And then this improved tribological performance is attributed to the formation of lubricious carbon cryofilm. And based on the investigation that we had conducted, we found that this cryofilm is in fact polymeric, although it can show some of the features, that is the presence of D and G bands in the Raman signal at room temperature, which is sometimes misconstrued as a DLC film. So caution must be taken before doing so. And then lastly, stronger adsorption is more critical than the metastability of the lubricant additive, which represents an important finding towards the understanding of these tribochemical reactions. Lastly, I would like to conclude by acknowledging important people and funding that was from NSF. I would like to acknowledge the work by Dr. Hongjin Pu and Mr. Chong Ma, who helped in some of the experimental results that I showed in this talk. Dr. Blake Johnson, who had started the work on CPCA, and Dr. Kiran of Argonne, who helped me in analyzing some of the MD simulations. And then lastly, I would like to point out that the work that I presented here is already published and available. So certainly if you are interested in the work that I presented here, and if you want to take a deep dive on some of the details behind these investigations, you are certainly welcome to read the already published papers. So with that, I would like to thank you all for your attention.